Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to our service this morning. And during these Sundays leading up to Christmas, these Advent Sundays, we're going to be lighting our candles. And in a moment, Maureen's going to come and light two candles, the candle from last week and the candle from this week. And as she does so, we're reminded that this candle today is a candle of hope. Now we light, I'm sorry, last week was a candle of hope. Now we light the candle for the second Sunday in Advent, the candle of peace. And as we prepare for the coming of Jesus, we remember that Jesus is our hope and our peace. From the prophet Isaiah says, "For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Almighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." And from the Gospel of John, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not be troubled." So let us pray. Gracious God, grant that we may find peace as we prepare for our Lord's birth. May divisions in ourselves and in our families be peacefully resolved. May there be peace in our cities and in the countries of our world. Help us to see the paths of peace in our lives, and then give us the courage to follow them. Lord, let us remember that you only are the giver of lasting peace, and that you are always with us. Amen. Amen. We come to worship this morning, and let's give ourselves to the one who has come, but the one who we anticipate coming this morning afresh into our lives, and who will ultimately come again. Let's stand and sing together.
Despise the cross, for even in your suffering you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation. Souls of all who'd come to the Father I would stand.
And the church
lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not fade. By his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God, altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Here I am.
see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross.
Please be seated. Have we any children this morning? No. So we don't have to release them to go to the rock. Okay, well, let's pray together. And just thinking around this theme of peace this morning, I'm going to pray into various areas where we think of peace. Peace, in a biblical sense, means shalom. That's about complete wholeness and about restoring things to how they were originally meant to be. And it's about relational harmony. And as we go through this, I'm just going to do it in a number of sections. And at the end of each section, I'm going to say, Lord, in your mercy, and if you can just respond by, give them peace. So, Lord, in your mercy, give them peace. Lord, we think, first of all, about our relationship with you. Praying particularly for those who live with guilt. Guilt for their own sin. Who have not found yet forgiveness. Those who are living with shame because of the way that other people have sinned against them and are caught in a trap of shame, and we pray for freedom for them. We pray for those who are suffering and feel abandoned by you, God, believing that you don't care. For those who struggle with prayer, where their prayer is dry and they don't hear from you. For those who don't have a relationship with you, God, at all. And for those who are asking, why? Lord, in your mercy, give them peace. We pray about our relationship with others. For those who have been hurt and wounded, whether that's in the past, sometimes distant past, or whether it's recent. For those who feel trapped by the control of others, trapped in violence and abusive relationships. For those who have suffered loss of spouse, family member, friend. Lord, in your mercy, give them peace. For those who struggle with their relationship with themselves, those suffering physically, who are in constant pain, those who struggle with mental health, who struggle with an unhelpful thought life, those whose lives are broken, who have identity issues of various kinds, of comfort issues, caught in addiction, for those who have guidance issues about what to do, and for those who live in fear. Lord, in your mercy, give them peace. And finally, we pray for those who have an unhelpful relationship with creation, with the environment in which they live. We think of war-torn and conflict situations throughout the world, particularly in Afghanistan. For those who are refugees, who have no settled place to live. For those who are trafficked into slavery of any kind. For those confined in prison, or even confined in their own home because of health or disability. Lord, in your mercy, give them peace. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to receive our morning offering now. As I say, offering is part of worship, and In it, we are expressing our gratitude to God, but we're also expressing our trust in God, that He will continue to provide for us. And we don't just offer as we give our money, or we recognize that we've given our money through the bank account, but we recognize that all that we have and all that we are comes from God. And we pray for the right use of all the resources that God has given. And just a warning about later in the service, we're going to reinstate the communion offering around communion. A communion offering is for the pastoral fund, which is really to help people who are sick, those in need, and great work that's being done in the church. And so this is a special offering that we will make each time we share in communion. If you've come prepared for that, great. If you haven't come prepared for it, then just recognize it as we make that offering. But this is the first offering, our general offering. Let's just give to God. Lord, as we bring these gifts to you, we do so in gratitude and trust, thanking for all that you have given to us in so many ways. Lord, will you be pleased to receive our gifts? Will you be pleased with how we give? And Lord, will you take, use, and bless all that we give in these moments, to be used for your glory. Amen. Just before Jan comes to bring our reading this morning, just want to say, when we listen to God's word, whether it's read or we're going to preach, can we do so with a sense of, I want to really hear from you this morning, God? And it's particularly so this morning because one of the things I want to say is this is a story about Jesus being conceived in the body of Mary. And that which was conceived was of the Holy Spirit, which we will find out next week when we think about the story of Joseph. But the Holy Spirit is always wanting to conceive something in us. Something that will be sparked off in us, an idea, a dream or something. And that will not immediately happen. We'll hold it, but it can never come to birth if it's never been conceived. And so I want us to hear the word this morning with that openness to receive the seed of God's word personally and individually, but also as a church. Because we want God to conceive something in us that will ultimately come to birth. Jan.
In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married, and a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel sent her, or went to her and said, "Greetings, you are highly favoured. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words, wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will be with child and give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of Most High. The Lord God will give him a throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. In his kingdom he will never end." How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One is to be born and called the Son of God. When Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, she who was said to be barren is in her sixth month. For nothing is impossible with God." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May it be me as you have said." The angel left her. At this time, Mary got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea, where she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped into her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. In a loud voice, she exclaimed, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. But I am so favored that the mother of the Lord should come to me. As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. Blessed she is who has believed that what the Lord has said to her was accomplished." Mary stayed with Elizabeth for about 3 months and then returned home.
Thank you, Jan. Just checking, Pete, I'd got down that we were going to sing song here. You unravel me with a melody. Were you expecting that? No, were you expecting it? We've got to be ready for the unexpected, haven't we? Really quite an interesting song. You may not know it very well, but it's about not being no longer slave to fear. And in a sense, it's relevant to the passage that we've just read and I'm going to speak on in a moment. Because in a way, Mary was being unraveled with a melody, but she was told not to be afraid. And if you actually trace the Christmas story, last week we had Zechariah was told, do not be afraid. This week we've got Mary is being told, do not be afraid. Next week we've got Joseph, he's being told, do not be afraid. The following week we've got the shepherds who are told, do not be afraid. Okay? So this is really quite significant that we are hearing this word, do not be afraid, this morning. And the song actually says, talks about being a child of God. And that's the only way that we can really combat fear, to know that we are held in the loving embrace of a Father who loves us, who cares for us, and to whom we belong. So let's sing this song together. You unravel me with a melody.
My fears were drowned in perfect love. You rescued me so I could stand and sing. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child. Let's sing that once more, but just use our voices. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God.
Because it's one thing to sing those words, they may not have been familiar to you, but I want to pray that those words would become a reality this morning. That whatever fears grip your life, whether that's just mild worry, whether it's more extreme anxiety, whether you are somebody who suffers panic attacks, or whether you just live with a constant sense of uncertainty, I want to pray that God will come this morning and deal with not just the symptoms of fear, but with the roots of fear. Lord, come this morning, we pray. And as we hear the words spoken to Mary, Lord, we anticipate them. We hear your word to us this morning. Do not be afraid. Fear not. Lord, we want to receive it. We want to have your absence of fear imparted to us, your peace that will replace fear. Not that we want to strive to go overcome fear, because we want to believe that you are dealing with our fear. So we pray that this morning, that somehow you will reassure us that our fears are being dealt with directly by you. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. A slave to fear, I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God.
We are no longer slaves.
No longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. No longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Amen. Let's sit down. Just be prepared for more ministry this morning. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent to a town in Nazareth. What do you mean by 6 months? Are we talking here about the month of June? It's 6 months of Elizabeth's pregnancy. You see, we've got to be careful. We don't split the Bible up into nice sections. This flows on from last week, from the story of Zechariah and Elizabeth and so on. So reference to the 6th month of Elizabeth's pregnancy. And we will find that that's significant here in this story as it continues. Last week, the angel Gabriel was sent to an old man, Zechariah, towards the end of his life with some good news. His prayer miraculously. Today, the angel Gabriel is sent to a young virgin teenager named Mary, a very ordinary person, as Del reminded us last week. Zechariah was; he was an ordinary person. Mary's an ordinary person. She's pledged to be married. Pledged to be married. It's not like today. If you're engaged. In those days, if you were pledged to be married, it was a binding agreement. The dowry had been paid. The groom could claim at any time after that. And there were legal aspects in the engagement more than in the marriage. She was engaged to be married to a great man, a man called Joseph, who we will discover next week. Always did what was right. The future was ahead of her. It looked really rosy and secure. And this angel appears to her. What's Mary's response to the angel? Startling. If the angel appeared this morning in front of you, you wouldn't just be casual about it, would you? You would be startled. It would be particularly startling to Mary. Not because she would have not expected it, but for 400 years before this, God had not spoken directly to his people. There'd been no angelic visitation, there'd been no direct word from God for 400 years, and suddenly an angel appears to this young girl, Mary. And she would have been startled. But the message that this angel brings is even more startling. And this morning, let's look what happens to Mary. Let's look how she engages with the angel. And let's see what we can discover about how we deal with those times when God meets with us. Gabriel's message came to a prepared heart. Mary was regarded as highly favoured. Not just favour, but highly favoured. We are all favoured by God. Surely. Matt, you're favoured by God. Add your name in. You are favoured by God. Not because of anything you've done, particularly, but because God's grace favours you. He delights in you. No matter what you feel like this morning, you are highly favoured by God. And God is pleased when our heart is towards him, when we love him with all our heart, when we're submissive and humble before him, but also when we're obedient. And Mary's obedience was not to a specific word from God. Mary's obedience was to what she had read in the scriptures. And she would not have been taught the scriptures as a woman, so she was actually being obedient to all that she had learned about God. It's important for us to know Scripture. It's important for us to read Scripture. The Lord says to Mary, can I say it again this morning? The Lord is with you. Nick, the Lord is with you. Sally, the Lord is with you. Carissa, the Lord is with you. Pete, the Lord is with you. Claire, the Lord is with you. The Lord's with us this morning. Isn't it? The Lord is with you. There's an intimacy of relationship. When you say, the Lord is with you, it means that his presence is there. He's actually actively present, but it also means he's for you. You know, I'm with you. Somebody says, I'm with you. I agree with you. I'm there for you. I'm coming along with you. I'm in harmony with you. That's what the Lord says to you this morning. The Lord is with you. And favor and presence are good seed beds, good soil for the seed to be planted and the seed to be received. Something conceived in us where our hearts are prepared. But Mary's troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. What's coming next? What will this mean? And she sees all the implications. I don't whether you're that sort of person. You know, you hear something and immediately you go to the ultimate conclusion of it. I don't know whether she was like that. She might have said, what's going on? But immediately, something is being threatened in her life. And she's becomes fearful. Do you know what fear means? Often, false expectations appearing real. Many of us live with false expectation. If you tell somebody, that's why God doesn't tell us what's going to happen. Because if we knew what was going to happen, we would be fearful of it. People have said to me, I wouldn't be able to cope if this happened. But it's amazing that when you actually reach that happening, you do cope. People cope with the most extreme circumstances that they would have believed not, it wouldn't be possible if they actually knew it was going to happen. And so Mary is reassured by the angel, do not be afraid. Is it a command that she has to be obeyed, or is it an impartation? I think it's an impartation, which is what I was praying earlier. You have found favor with God. Something different here. Not that just Mary is favored, but she has found favor with God. And God is looking for people who stir God's favor. Stir God's special favor because of a lifestyle that pleases him. See, Mary was showing here that she could be trusted with the most important thing that God could trust anybody with. Could trust her to parent his son coming to earth. Are we people who God can trust? And then the angel goes on to give further explanation, and you get all this detail. By the way, I don't know how long it took the angel to say all those things to Mary, but I think it would have been quite difficult for her to actually grasp onto all that. But actually what the angel is saying is Isaiah 9 is being fulfilled. A virgin will be with child and so on. We read it earlier. And Mary's puzzled, and she asks the questions. And the first question she asks goes right back to the first thing the angel says. How will this be since I am a virgin? She's stuck on that first statement. Never mind all the other things. She's stuck on the first one, which was, you will be with child. And she thinks along human lines. Of course she does. And of course we do, don't we? We think along human lines. We think rationally, with our natural reason. But she's able to question. Because questioning helps to take it in, to come to terms with it. Trying to think how it will happen. And that's what we need to do often. We need to weigh this. We need to be able to ask the questions. Because if we don't, it will actually settle on doubt and uncertainty and so on. It will lie dormant and undetected. And so the angel answers with further assurance. And he points Mary towards the supernatural activity of God. God's going to do this. Let God conceive this. The Holy Spirit will come upon you. Can I say to us this morning, let's pray that the Holy Spirit will come upon us. Pray regularly that the Holy Spirit will come upon you. But let's, as a church, pray that the Holy Spirit will come upon us. That we move from just being natural and living in the natural, but we move to live in the supernatural. When we allow God to do what is humanly, naturally, impossible, and we'll come to that word in a moment. It's important that the supernatural is allowed to happen. The Holy Spirit will come upon you, the power of the Most High will overshadow you, and so the Holy One born will be called Son of God. Basically, Mary, all you have to do this morning is say yes. All you've got to do this morning is say yes to God. That's so easy, isn't it? All you've got to do is say yes. It's important to submit to God, but it's important to move more in the supernatural. And the angel then answers with more encouragement. And he points to Elizabeth's pregnancy. Your cousin Elizabeth, she's old. She's beyond. She can't have children. And yet, she's 6 months pregnant. Now, Mary knew nothing about that until the angel told her. Because we heard at the end of last week that Elizabeth went into seclusion for 6 months. So Mary didn't know any of that. For nothing is impossible with God. I've had problems with that phrase for a long time, not personally, but I've had problems with it when people take that word out of context. There are two contexts in the Bible where that word comes. Nothing is impossible with God. And it's always specific. The first time is very similar to what was said about Elizabeth. It's in the story of Abraham and Sarah. And Abraham is told that Sarah, equal sort of situation, is going to have a baby. Sarah laughs, actually. And God says nothing is impossible with God. Because God has spoken the word, and when he's spoken a word, it becomes completely possible. But I've heard people actually take that word and say, oh, well, we've got this situation here, and it looks huge, but nothing is impossible with God. It's not a good use of Scripture. Now, it's true, nothing is impossible with God. But when God speaks that word, he speaks it because he has given a promise. And he is true to his promise. So we hold on to the promise, believing that what looks totally impossible will happen because God said it will happen. Nothing is impossible with God. It's not a prescription to put into every situation of impossibility. It's very specific. We sustain faith when our faith is in God and in the word he has spoken. And God will always be true to his word. The angel, in a sense, gives a testimony of what's happened to Elizabeth. And testimony is so important. We need to hear testimonies of what God has done and God is doing. We're going to hear one a little bit later. Because when we hear a testimony, it stirs our faith to believe in God. And part of the meaning of the word testimony is do it again. Do it again. Not do the identical thing again, but do it again. Do something again, God. Because we believe that you're able to do it. It stimulates faith. And then Mary reaches this place of acceptance and submission. I am the Lord's servant. May be to me as you have said. I'll do whatever you want. Don't know how long it took. I don't think it took 2 minutes, which is how long it took to read that. I don't know how long it took. We get the condensed version. And then Mary gets ready and hurries to a town in the hill country, the home of Zechariah and Elizabeth. Why did she do that? Just think for a moment. Why did she do that? Was it to help her cousin? Old woman? First baby? She'll need some help.
No.
She went to a place where she went to a faith environment. There would be little evidence in Mary at that point that what the angel had said had happened. There'd be nothing in her body that would actually say it's true. But if she went to Elizabeth's, she would be faced every day with this old woman who couldn't have children being pregnant. And so obviously pregnant. She would be faced every day with God's promise fulfilled, with the miraculous. And there are some environments that are faith environments where there's real belief and expectancy in the active presence of God today through the Holy Spirit. Where the Holy Spirit to be supported in and where God is alive and active. Where there's revelation from God and radical obedience to those words. But there are also faith environments which are absent of faith, where there's no expectancy, where the gifts of the Spirit are not and a natural human and rational answer. Jesus experienced that. He could do no miracles in a certain town. Why? Because of their lack of faith. So if Jesus couldn't do any miracles because of their faith environment, it must be that the faith environment is a vital part of God doing things, isn't it? Let's pray that Godalming Baptist Church is a faith environment, a faith-filled environment. Expect the Holy Spirit to be at work. Expect to see the miraculous. And then further encouragement as she gets to Elizabeth's, the baby leaps in Elizabeth's womb. Something natural happens and Elizabeth has revelation that it's more than just natural. She's filled with the Holy Spirit. And she confirms what the angel said to Mary. See, Mary's only greeted her, told her no news, and yet Elizabeth says, "Blessed is the child you will bear." How did she know that? She only knew it because of revelation. Blessed, why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? She even recognizes who this baby is. It's the Lord. It's God. And nobody's told her except God. And the baby leaps for joy. And that section almost finishes with, "Blessed is she who has believed that what the Lord has said to her will be accomplished." Elizabeth affirms Mary's faith that what God has said will happen, encourages Mary to go on believing in response to the Lord's word to her, stands with her, points to the blessing of faith obedience. And how long did Mary stay? How long did she stay with Elizabeth and Zechariah? 3 months. Why? Why did she stay 3 months and then went home? Well, she stayed until John was born. She stayed until Zechariah spoke again and said his name is John. She stayed until 3 months. What happens at 3 months when you're pregnant, around that sort of time? I'm told. There's a sense within yourself, isn't there? That you are actually carrying a baby. Mary would have had real confirmation in her own body that she really was pregnant. And so she returned home, ready to face all that God had chosen for her, trusting a God who was and would be faithful, and who in turn trusted her with the most significant responsibility ever. Do you think she knew what she would actually be facing? Do you think she did? While you reflect on it, we're going to watch a video of a song. And it says, "Mary, did you know that your baby boy..." Just have a listen before we move on into communion. Hopefully, please. Yes, we've got it.
Face of God, oh Mary.
wonder if she'd known all that, whether she'd still have gone ahead with it. Mentioned testimony earlier. Nick, do you want to come? Nick's going to come and share his testimony, and let it stimulate our faith as we move into communion.
Thank you for letting me speak, just for a couple of minutes. I wanted to talk about my experience. I am very new to faith, 18 months, which actually, funnily enough, is the amount of time that I've been caring for Sam and the Barringer family. Which leads me on to why I came to faith and why I became a Christian. I did the Alpha course at Three Counties Church in Hammer, near Hazelmere. My wife is a Christian, and she pushed me and pushed me and pushed me to go. I really didn't want to go. I didn't know what to expect. I was fearful. And after a few sessions, I found myself really committed to this and to what Jesus and the Holy Spirit was saying to me. I remember going to one Hillsong evening, and this incredible, amazing feeling all across my chest happened to me during worship. And I remember that I could not go back from that moment. I knew then that Jesus was real, the Holy Spirit was real, the Bible was real, everything. And from that moment, I got a brand new job working for a Christian family. I have a beautiful wife. And now we are expecting our first child in June. So life has been fantastic for me because I made that decision and because I believed that there was a greater good. So thank you.
Thank you, Nick.
Yeah, just great, isn't it? Does that stir your faith? You know, people becoming Christians today. Yeah, great. So we're going to move into communion together. The people who are serving at communion, if you can come and join me. Just as we're coming to communion, and it's the fellowship meal, and this is the time that we are actually going to think about our fellowship with God, but also our fellowship with one another. Some news: Fatmata, a member here, just recently tested positive for COVID. So if we could pray for her and for grace and so on. As we think about the ministry of the fellowship, just to say that the items for the food bank, the things that are needed for regular and for Christmas, all that detail has been updated. So you can look at that and so on. But let's remind ourselves what's happening here. And Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. He tore it apart and gave it to his disciples and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this and remember me. Let what happens now go on being real in your new present and your new future." And in the same way also the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it and remember me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. You proclaim not just that he died, but you proclaim everything that was achieved in his death. And it's until he comes. What a great thing to remind ourselves of on this second Sunday of Advent, thinking of the coming of Jesus, that we'll, one day all this will stop. Because he'll have come. Might be today. Unlikely. I say that not because I don't have faith, but that I think there are things that need to be accomplished before it will happen. But the early church expected it to happen any moment. So we're going to serve communion. You will find that there, if you don't feel comfortable taking the bread, then there are the little sachets and so on. So let's receive the bread and we'll eat it as we receive it. The body of Christ broken for you. As we receive the wine, we'll keep the cup and then we'll drink together as a sign and symbol of our unity together in Jesus.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close.
Jesus.
Of love, my heart becomes free, my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what I to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for you, and be thankful. Lord, we say thank you in so many ways for so many different things. Some of them really quite small. We want to be people of gratitude, but when we say thank you to you this morning for the fact that you gave your life for us, thank you seems such a small word, and we want you to just magnify it, Lord, to us, but from us to you. We are thankful. Thank you, oh my Father, for giving us your Son and leaving your Spirit till the work on earth is done. Amen. Amen.
The finish with this song is that looking at the words of the bridge, it says, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the ground. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the ground. Those words, we need to let them eat into our hearts.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? His love is mighty
and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth? Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless with awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all. This is amazing grace. This is amazing grace. Unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. Oh, you lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings that chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of his brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. You are worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
And keep you, sustain, protect, provide for you, that you will know security. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May you know the loving smile of God, who delights in you, who values you, to whom you are precious. And may the Lord turn his face towards you, take notice of you, because you are significant, you matter to him, and all that matters to you matters to him. And may he grant you shalom, peace, a sense of total well-being with him, within yourself, with other people, and with the environment in which you live and move and have your being. And I speak over you the name of the Lord, the active, manifest presence of God. Amen. Amen.